The Rosary is one of the Church's most powerful and treasured prayers. It also has one of the richest histories of any Catholic devotion. Join us today as we examine this great prayer with our special guest, Father Don Calloway, a priest with the Marians of the Immaculate Conception and author of the new book, Champions of the Rosary, The History and Heroes of a Spiritual Weapon. I'm Michael Hernon, Vice President of Advancement at Franciscan University in Steubenville, Ohio, and you're watching Franciscan University Presents. Stay with us. Welcome to Franciscan University Presents. Today we'll be talking about the Rosary. I'm Michael Hernon, Vice President of Advancement here at Franciscan University in Steubenville, Ohio. And I'll be your host, and I'm joined here in our studios by our regular panelist, Dr. Regis Martin, Professor of Systematic Theology, again here at Franciscan, and Dr. Scott Hahn, who holds the Father Michael Scanlon Chair in Biblical Theology and the New Evangelization, again at Franciscan. And we're joined by a very special guest, Father Don Calloway. You're a priest of the Marians of the Immaculate Conception. You're an alum of Franciscan University. You got your philosophy and theology degree here. You went on and you got your Master's of Divinity and Bachelor's in Sacred Theology from the Dominican House of Studies. So it's good to see an ecumenical flavor to your background, as well as your licentiate in Sacred Theology from the International Marian Research Institute in Dayton, Ohio. You've written the book that we're going to talk about today, Champions of the Rosary, the book that I'm a big fan of, No Turning Back, Your Conversion Story. I think there's about seven books that you've written, and it is a joy to have you with us. And I know you're in Steubenville only a little bit, so we're glad we got you today.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It's a real honor, really. It is a blessing to be back here. I love this university and everything it represents, so it's an honor.
Well, thank you. And today we're talking about the Rosary. And instead of jumping too far into St. Dominic and everything right away, let's start with what the Rosary actually is. Many know it as a popular devotion, but there's plenty that may not be aware what the Rosary actually is. So what does the Rosary consist of?
Yeah, probably the simplest definition I could give you is what some saints have already said. And it is, the Rosary is the Bible on beads, is what it is, basically.
Okay.
It's a New Testament on a set of ordinary prayer beads. Okay. And prayer beads have been in use for centuries, you know. But with this development of this particular devotion, it became a way of basically having prayer be portable, where you could go anywhere, pray at any time, and basically any function, you know, whether you're walking or driving, whatever it is, you can use this special form of prayer based in the Word of God, coming right out of the New Testament, with the Our Father from the lips of our Lord Himself. What better prayer could you get? And the Hail Mary, which grew over time from the announcement of the angel Gabriel to Our Lady, and then St. Elizabeth filled with the Holy Spirit, saying, you know, that Mary is filled with grace, and she's, you know, who am I that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Blessed are you among women, you know, and so you combine those prayers, and that's the essence of the Rosary.
Yeah.
And you meditate on it.
Right. You know, it's not just a Bible on beads. It's oftentimes a Bible on speed. I know people who can get through it in about 7 minutes.
The rapid fire rosary.
Right. Yeah.
I hope that's as efficacious. I don't know.
Heaven will probably accept it, but yeah.
Right.
There's a priest in Ireland, Father Gabriel Hardy. He was a great promoter of the Rosary, still living. I think he's almost 100 years old. He reminds people, he said, just like the road sign says on the highway, speed kills. Slow down when you pray the Rosary. Don't go so fast.
Well, in Ireland is where I heard it the fastest.
Yeah,
so that's good. He's preaching it well. So we know it's the Our Father, the 10 Hail Marys in a decade. We know the Glory Be. We know there's an evolution. Reading your book, there's an evolution of these prayers. How long has the Rosary been prayed in the Church? What's kind of a little bit of the history, if you will?
Yeah, it is a fascinating history. So the way that we've been praying it now, pretty much for 800 years, it's been prayed in this form. There's been various additions and adaptations and so forth. But there were actually things that predated the Rosary that were not the Rosary itself, but they were forms of praying the Our Fathers on a set of beads called Pater Noster beads, Our Father beads.
Okay.
But there were no meditations attached to it, no set of mysteries. It was just a devotional form to kind of supplement those who weren't able to participate in the Liturgy of the Hours, couldn't read Latin.
Right.
So they were able to pray this form as a substitution.
Yeah.
And then it developed And the 12th century, with the Cistercians and the Carthusians, mm-hmm. who really developed really strong Marian themes from the wisdom literature of the Old Testament, mm-hmm. And then bringing that kind of devotion into those beads. And those became known as the Marian Psalter.
Yeah. Okay.
And then we get St. Dominic in the 13th century, and that's the last 800 years of technically the Rosary as we have it.
Okay. I like that comparison to the Psalter because, of course, there are 150 Psalms, yeah. and in the traditional form, you have 50 for three sets of mysteries. Yeah. And so it really was a sort of peasant's breviary.
Right.
You know,
yeah,
so the poor folk who didn't have the divine office nevertheless could unite their hearts and their prayers.
It is, I think, telling that while it remains a school of sanctity for the simple people who can't read, some pretty learned people have been praying the Rosary. Yeah. John Paul II, it was his favorite mm-hmm. prayer.
Yes.
And Benedict, Pope Benedict, recalls seeing him on his knees, steeped in contemplative prayer.
Right.
So even for the learned, there's an attraction. And mm-hmm. that, I think, testifies to the wonderful diversity of the family of God.
Yeah, I know, absolutely.
And so we had some elements of a Marian Psalter a little bit before, or predating kind of St. Dominic to
right.
some degree, right?
Mm-hmm.
At least as I see in your book here.
Yeah.
But as St. Dominic came, what was the story? What happened there? Because St. Dominic is the founder of the Rosary as we see it,
right.
or at least bringing it forward from Our Lady. So what was that story around St. Dominic?
Yeah, so in the 13th century, you had a particular heresy called Albigensianism, which was really problematic, and it was causing a lot of problems in Europe, especially in France. And it was saying basically that only spiritual things are good, the flesh is bad. Mm-hmm. So it was denying many of the embodied mysteries of Christianity. So this priest, who was just a diocesan priest at the time, St. Dominic Guzman, was doing his best to combat it, but he wasn't having much success. Then he basically made a retreat, and Our Lady came to him, and she said to him, this is what the tradition says, she said to him, "Preach my Psalter." And that's important why she said that, because she was referring to what was already in existence, but she was going to give him the mysteries to be associated with it, which would be the same mysteries that the Albigensians were attacking.
Wow.
So he would
yeah.
take this form of devotion out into the streets and equip it to become basically a weapon of evangelization and bring back the heretics. And it worked. It absolutely worked, and we've been doing the same thing ever since.
Yeah, yeah. So he was trying to fight the good fight. He was
right.
out there trying to defend the faith,
yeah.
But he knew it wasn't sufficient. He
right.
needed more, and he
right.
had the spiritual weapons to come.
Well, that vision that he had from the Blessed Virgin is really inspiring.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, she pretty much tells him that when my son willed to renew the world, he sort of fertilized it
yes.
with all of these Hail Marys.
Mm.
And then she
mm.
exhorts him, you preach that right. Psalter
right.
of Hail Marys. And see what I can do.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting to read your chronicle of the ebb and the flow, the ups and the downs, because mm. you would think with that sort of success, it would just go from glory to glory. But I mean,
right.
with the Black Plague and other things, you know, there really are, at moments of history, great recoveries,
yeah.
retrievals of this Marian Psalter. And sometimes it has a decisive impact. You know, Lepanto comes to
mm-hmm.
mind, of
yes.
course,
mm-hmm.
but
yes.
but many others as well.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, so from very early on, we saw very unique characters of it, but it had this ebb and flow, you know? And how did it kind of evolve, if you will? I mean, again, it probably in its essence, it was always the same for the last 800 years,
mm-hmm.
But there were a number of not embellishments, but different changes that kind of really
yeah.
made it. And then were even times when it finally became not just the Marian Psalter, but the Rosary, and
right.
Commonly known at least. You know, then you had another Dominican who kind of revived it,
mm-hmm.
and you had the Black Plague, where it was almost an exile, it seemed,
yes,
right?
Yeah. Oh, the history of it's amazing. I mean, we'd probably have to do about 20 shows to get it all
I
in.
I hope
there.
You do.
That's a good idea, probably.
Or maybe put it in a book at least.
it's definitely all in there.
Both and.
It's probably the thickest book ever written.
Yeah, I'm wondering what's not in there.
exactly.
And the endorsements, you've got about as many as there are beads on that rosary.
Right.
And
right.
from some pretty impressive people, Cardinal mm-hmm. Schoenborn,
mm-hmm.
but he's a Dominican,
yeah.
right?
And
right.
Father DeNoia,
yeah.
who
yeah.
practically runs the Holy Office,
right.
another Dominican, but they give you unstinting praise for
yeah.
the scholarship and piety that you display.
Yeah, it's funny how I got those too, because I thought, well, we'll see. The bishops are so busy, and so I sent the manuscript to some. I didn't expect any responses back, you know. And then one responded with just such praise, and I said, well, that was easy. So I just started sending out the manuscript, and all of a sudden I started getting it back. I said, uh-oh, now I've got to put these in there. Yeah. And, you know, it does give it a backing, you know,
right,
that,
yeah, sure,
you know, it's worthy of our attention.
Yeah, yeah. And there was a, I think, Regis, you may have alluded to this, but there was I can't remember if it was the which of the kind of the saints or blessed isn't here, but there was a concern about the intellectual, you know, he was a very high intellectual, and this was a very devotional prayer.
Right.
And there was this kind of conflict of sorts,
oh, yeah,
you know.
Well, that's probably Blessed Alain de la Roche.
Yes, that's right.
I love this story. You know, our Lord, as the tradition says, appeared to him on one occasion to renew the rosary. After the Black Plague killed one-third of Europe, like over 25 million people died in the 14th century. And of course, people were more worried about survival than, you know, praying the rosary at that time. Mm-hmm. It was a serious, serious time. Our Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The world is filled with ravenous wolves, and you, unfaithful dog, know not how to bark."
Wow.
That is strong.
Wow.
Right.
Wow.
Why would our Lord say that? Well, remember, Blessed Alain de la Roche was a son of St. Dominic, and Dominicans, the Dominicanis, traditionally known as the dogs of God.
Yeah.
So you're a Dominican, and you've got the barking method, the rosary. You're not barking.
Right.
So he's telling him, bark.
Wow.
Promote the,
yeah,
rosary.
Yeah.
Love it.
Wow.
That's very expressive.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
God had the gift of gab.
Yeah, our Lord, you know, to Saul on the road to Damascus, does it hurt to kick against the goads? You know, like a little sacred sarcasm, you know.
God's good with those things.
I was struck by one comment from Frank Duff, who's a servant of God, I think, who founded the Legion of Mary. But he claims that every saint since the 13th century had recourse to the rosary. It was sort of an habitual form of devotion.
Yeah, I probably say that he's right.
Yeah, that's convicting.
It is convicting, yeah. And also, you know, he didn't say this, but probably he would. Probably every pope as well, you know, since that time has prayed it. So if you want to grow in virtue, you know, it's a good means.
Right. So we've set a pretty good stage that throughout history this has been rested on ups and downs, the heresies, mm-hmm, and the reformations and the black plagues and into modern day. You know, you have a lot of great people, both the Pope as well as popes as well as laymen who have really done this. What about you personally? What's your story with the rosary?
I definitely have one, and I mentioned it in the introduction to the book. And that's part of the reason I wrote the book, because, you know, I'm a convert to Catholicism. And when I was becoming Catholic, I met, you know, these little warriors of truth, these little Filipino women who, you know, in parishes across the world are praying the rosary every day. And I learned it from them as I was going through my conversion process and becoming Catholic. And ever since then, I mean, I go everywhere with my rosary. I pray it every day. And I thought, you know, we need a book today like St. Louis de Montfort's masterpiece, The Secret of the Rosary. Mm-hmm. We need something like that, but updated with all the many things that have happened since then. That was written 3 centuries ago. And so I thought, well, I better do it before somebody attempts it and does it poorly. Yeah. So let's do it. So it took me 3 years, and I poured my heart into that in thanksgiving to Our Lady for what the rosary has done for me.
Mm-hmm. And I think about, as we're in the 100th year of the apparitions in Fatima, and just the importance of Our Lady and her apparitions. She's coming to us. She's pleading with us. She's always calling us, pray, pray, pray.
Well, also 800 years since was invented
by
Our Lady and
that's
given
to
Dominic.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it always seems it's around the marriage and family, these issues. And
it
Father Peyton who said that the family who prays together is the family that stays together?
Yeah. Right. No, I think intellectuals, though, especially need it.
You speak to that.
if it's the peasant's breviary, you know, I would say that intellectuals are the ones who suffer from spiritual poverty more than most. It's the occupational hazard, the besetting sin. And I find that intellectuals who pray the rosary, this has been my favorite prayer for more than 30 years since becoming Catholic, and even 2 or 3 years before I became a Catholic. Mm-hmm. It was the single biggest obstacle, not just Marian doctrine, but Marian devotion. And what my grandmother used to pray that I found so off-putting, she would hardly talk about much. You know, she was quiet, devout, beautiful soul, but I mean, superstitious, a Catholic. But she didn't go anywhere without that rosary. And when she died, they gave it to me, and I broke them like chains that I thought bound her in superstition. And then she had the last laugh, you know. But I really believe that academics, intellectuals, theologians, I mean, Ratzinger, Pope Benedict himself, made it a point that he prays this every day. And as an academic, he admitted some difficulties too at times, you know, but nothing makes the gospel come alive, you know, and the episodes as well. Nothing reminds us, proud peacocks, that we're little infants, we're children in her arms, you know, and I think it really supernaturalizes the otherwise natural process that can become easily naturalistic, you know. And it just, I have found this to be the testimony of many of my colleagues. It's a silent testimony. It isn't something that we want to advertise, you know, but it's something we want to do and encourage others to do.
Absolutely.
Well, Scott, that's pretty astonishing. I've known you maybe 25 years. I had no idea you had a grandmother who was a Catholic, who probably had a greater impact on your conversion than all those blooming books.
Oh, believe me, there's a backstory, and I know you're right as rain. I mean, yes.
She's smiling from a higher vantage point.
That is true. That is true. Stay with us for the next segment of Franciscan University Presents.
When I pray the Rosary, I like to meditate on how Mary would have reacted during each mystery, in her sorrow, her joy, and her awe.
Men need to stop worrying about looking masculine when praying the Rosary, because it really is a masculine thing. I get together with 15 or 20 other men every week and we pray the Rosary together. And it really is a masculine thing, because we come together as brothers, and Mary's maternity gathers us together as brothers, and there's really nothing more manly than brotherhood.
St. Louis de Montfort tells us that Marian devotion is the safest, shortest, and easiest way to heaven. So I pray the Rosary to grow in Marian virtue and devotion, that she may draw me closer to her Son, Jesus.
Welcome back to Franciscan University Presents. We've been talking about champions of the Rosary, the history and heroes of a spiritual weapon with Father Don Calloway, author. Father Don, this has been a good foundation for us. And as the title, the champions of the Rosary, what does it take to be a champion? A champion of the Rosary. I mean, is this, they have to go to mortal combat, right? And I love the cover with the sword and shields and the crown. But what does it take to be a champion of the Rosary? How would you define that from the book?
Yeah, not much, really. Pope Benedict XVI, during his pontificate, he said that to be an apostle of the Rosary, basically first you have to be one who loves the Rosary. Okay. So you have to pray the Rosary. Sure. But then there's other means that you can champion it. And that would be just to let others know about it. Invite people to pray the Rosary with you, or give them books about the Rosary. You know, it's very simple. Anyone can become a champion of the Rosary. And there have been many champions throughout history who have not written books about it.
Sure.
But, you know, think about all those ladies in church every day praying the Rosary for their grandchildren and children. They're champions of the Rosary.
Yeah. I think of my mom who taught me the Rosary, you know.
Right.
That's the woman I think of. But when we started earlier talking about St. Dominic, and he'd probably be the first champion of the Rosary, as you laid out in the book. What are some other champions, and how do they contribute to the Rosary and the spiritual life of the church then?
Yeah, in the book specifically, I focus on 26 that are kind of the major players. So after St. Dominic, you get Blessed Alain de la Roche, who renewed it when it had kind of fallen away. But then you get like St. Louis de Montfort, you know, a Third Order Dominican, who really is probably one of the greatest known for promoting the Rosary. Then you get others that are less known, that are incredible, like St. Anthony Mary Claret, for example. An unbelievable guy. Our Lady appeared to him, and he writes this in his autobiography. Our Lady appeared to him on several occasions and said to him that you will be the new St. Dominic for these times. Yeah. So when he was made a bishop in Cuba, he mandated that all of his priests had to pray the Rosary with the faithful on Sundays and solemnities in the church. Mm. And he would sneak in the back and make sure they were doing it. If they weren't, he would walk right up front and do it himself. So, I mean, that's all. We could use a few of those today.
Right? You skip Pope Pius V.
Of course, right. A Dominican pope.
That's right.
Greatest ever. Right. Yeah. If it wasn't for him, we'd probably all be Muslim today, as a matter of fact. You know, I mean, because of the Rosary and Lepanto and the Holy League, he basically saved Christianity and Western civilization.
Tell the story of Lepanto. I think that's a great
story. Oh, it's an incredible story.
So many young people don't know that story. Yeah.
I know. So in the 16th century, when Christianity had already become divided, unfortunately, because of the Protestant revolt, the rebellion, The radical Muslims took advantage of that division and sought to conquer Rome. Yes. And so they were amassing this huge military militia, naval fleet. Well, the Pope didn't sit around and wait for him to come to St. Peter's. He formed a Holy League and asked all of Christendom to pray the Rosary. He was a Dominican Pope. Yeah. And so this great battle in 1571, the Battle of Lepanto, it's a bay near Greece, with an unskilled army, and much of Christendom didn't even respond because they weren't interested in defending, Catholicism in particular. But the ones who did went off and they did battle with the Muslims and
outgunned.
Farmers coming from Venice and other places that didn't really know much about these kind of things. But with the prayer of the Rosary, won this battle in miraculous ways.
Yeah.
In 1571. And that really turned the tide. And from that, we got the Feast of the Rosary, would develop in its name, Our Lady of Victory, then become Our Lady of the Rosary. And Rosary Sunday, which unfortunately is no longer in existence, but when you read the book, you'll find out about that one unbelievable day that we used to celebrate.
Right.
So there's a lot of history there.
There's some marvelous details about that. Don Juan of Austria, he forbids blasphemy on the boats, and they fast for 3 days. Everybody gets a rosary. Yeah. Miguel Cervantes, who wrote Don Quixote, he was a part of that fleet, I think was severely wounded, but evidently survived and went on to write Don Quixote.
Right.
And it was a quixotic sort of enterprise to take on the Muslim and to win and to liberate all of those captives as well.
I think it's very interesting that you have many women that I know, my mother among them, who pray the rosary, who you see praying the rosary.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, as I read this and I think back, it was obviously many men who received this, a prayer to a mother, to a queen mother.
Right.
And it's very connected to military battles and even that this is the weapon of war. I think it's very interesting that we see this. Very interesting time where men are being called to get to their knees when there's battles all around them. I just think it's very, it reminds us today where we need to be as men particularly.
I agree. I couldn't agree more because a lot of people think that the rosary is just for little old ladies and when somebody dies at a funeral. But they need to be reminded the rosary was first given to a man, to St. Dominic.
Right.
And, before the Battle of Lepanto, there was the great siege of Malta in 1565, 6 years before Lepanto. This one is special to me. I love this. Well, the Muslims had 40,000, soldiers and sailors. They were going to attack Malta, strategic way to get to Rome.
Mm-hmm.
The Catholics on that island had 6,000. That's it. 6,000 against 40,000. The leader of the Knights of Malta went to a blacksmith and said, "Make me a sword," and put on the blade the rosary. And they held off 40,000 Muslims. Matter of fact, 30,000 Muslims were gone after that battle.
Wow.
So, and that sword is still in existence today at the Church of Our Lady of Damascus in the city of Bergu. You can go to the museum. That same sword is still there today.
That is powerful.
Well, so is Islam still with us. And I think we need to revive the rosary as a weapon.
Mm-hmm. Would you say there's any generation that has produced more champions of the rosary than another? Is there something that stands out? Obviously, we've had many throughout the years, but is there any time frame that you think had a plethora of champions?
Yeah, for sure. I would say probably beginning with the apparitions to Our Lady of Lourdes, so in the mid-19th century, up until the present, so it's a big space of time, but 150 years, we're talking about a pope, Pope Leo XIII, during that time, who wrote 11 encyclicals on the rosary.
Wow.
I mean, that's unbelievable.
Yes. Yeah.
Right? What else was he doing? It was writing encyclicals.
That's right.
And then you have a former satanic priest who, becomes an apostle of the rosary, Blessed Bartolo Longo. It's an amazing story.
And that was Our Lady of, Pompeii?
Our Lady of the Rosary of Pompeii.
It is,
He's just unbelievable. And then, of course, you get apparition after apparition, the approved ones. In the 20th century, Our Lady of Fatima, talking about the rosary, Our Lady of Bano, Burang, and they just keep coming, all throughout the 20th century, culminating really in the pontificate of John Paul II, who gives us a new set of mysteries in 2002, says the rosary is his favorite prayer just 2 weeks into his pontificate.
Yeah.
Right. And, this is the time of the rosary, really.
He was a witness to that in so many ways.
There are saints and then there are hidden saints, and most saints are hidden saints. There are champions and then there are hidden champions.
Yeah.
And I think of so many people, like you mentioned, the Filipino Catholic women, who leave books in the back or whatever. I remember the secret of the rosary was left in the back of a parish that I was visiting. And it changed my life, and it changed, I'm sure, many others as well. But I really, you know, Padre Pio just stands out in my mind because, you know, getting the stigmata in 1918 and then not dying until 1960, 50 years bleeding in those bleeding hands, holding the rosary, praying probably millions and millions of Hail Marys and saving millions of souls.
And I mean,
our Lord using him in the way
that was... He insisted throughout that never would she turn him down.
Right,
whatever
yeah.
he needed, yeah. He would get through devotion to that prayer.
Oh, absolutely. And he called it a weapon.
A weapon.
He referred to it as
a
weapon.
Yeah.
Right. Get me my
weapon.
A weapon
for our times.
That's right,
you
yeah.
know, and the 20th century, in a certain way, your book shows me, is sort of like, you know, more is happening in that one century than all of the previous centuries, and yet it really is the culmination of all the previous centuries.
Yeah.
And it spills over into our time, maybe more, much more.
Right, right. Yeah. yeah. I mean, yeah. think about St. Maximian Kolbe, right?
right?
And he referred to the rosary as the sword for the Knights of the Immaculata, you know, the militia. And then you've got Father Patrick Peyton.
Right.
Nobody in the history of the church has got more people to gather to pray the rosary than this holy priest who's a servant of God. Millions he would gather in the streets.
Right.
That's
yeah.
not, even in San Francisco in 1961, he got 500,000 people to pray the rosary. That's unbelievable.
But you're right, John Paul really took it to the next level. I remember with a convert zeal trying to get my family to pray a rosary every night with maternal moderation. Kimberly would say, you know, an after dinner decade until the year of the rosary was called by John Paul.
Is that right?
And
yeah.
then she said, let's just try it. And I mean, all of our kids, you know, two of them are going to be, you know, one's in seminary, the other one's hoping to enter this fall, you know, and the family rosary,
yes.
like so many other, you know, homes,
yeah,
we just experienced such an island. Of
well, what a sunburst on his part to give us the luminous mysteries
yes.
as a way of combating the salient shortcomings of yes. the age, to stress the importance of baptism, the essential need to convert, mm-hmm. the sanctity of marriage,
yes.
the centrality
yes.
of the Eucharist,
right,
the
yeah.
divinity of Christ. I mean, these are the characteristic errors
it is
of
yeah.
our time.
And it really shows that, you know, when Our Lady gave the initial mysteries to St. Dominic, they combated the errors of that time.
Right.
Well, at that time, nobody was questioning, you know, who can marry who. You know, and back in the 13th
right.
century, it was obvious it was a man and a woman. Well, today, everything's confused.
Yeah.
So we get these luminous mysteries, which I love to say that all that St. John Paul II did was resharpen the ancient blade of the rosary and give us a modern-day lightsaber, you know, luminous mysteries to combat these dark times that we live in.
Yeah.
And another fascinating thing about that is St. John Paul II actually really is technically not the inventor of the luminous mysteries per se. They existed before even Vatican II, and a particular holy priest from Malta, interestingly mm-hmm. enough, named St. George Preca.
I see.
Yeah, and so he was beatified in 2001, and almost the whole world missed it.
Mm-hmm. He was by John Paul II.
By John Paul II, beatified him, the real inventor of the luminous mysteries. And then he gave us the luminous mysteries in 2002, St. John Paul II, and then Pope Benedict XVI canonized St. George Preca.
I think
it was in 2005, I think, something like, or six.
Mm-hmm. Well, did he footnote this guy, or was it just...
He put his trademark
on it.
He referred to him because that's how I found out about it too.
Yeah, but
when
it was
I went
unknown
to, visit Malta.
To the popular.
Right. It really
yeah.
was.
Yeah. Right.
We went out of our way in Malta to,
well,
to
you
track
know
down.
I think John Paul II does that with Faustina and other things. He takes people
correct.
That might not be, they might be hidden from the world and drawn out.
Right. Well, in Dives Misericordia, right, his second encyclical, he never mentions like the Divine Mercy devotion per se, but it's very obvious that he's referring to St. Faustina.
Yes.
Same thing in Rosarium Virginis Mariae. 2002, you know, St. George Preca is in there.
Yeah. Well, we've talked a lot about some of the leaders of the church that were champions of the rosary. What about some of the lay members that were out there championing the rosary?
Oh, there have been tons. Probably the one that I really highlight in my book is Frank Duff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just incredible. I mean, what he did with the
I was so impressed
Mary,
in reading one.
He's incredible. Wow. He's incredible. I want to see that man canonized. He, you know, a nobody from Ireland at the time, and he founds the Legion of Mary, which became, you know, even to the Mao Zedong, called the Legion of Mary public enemy number one.
Which I was surprised. I didn't know that.
Because during the 1940s and 50s, there was hardly a parish globally that did not have a Legion of Mary associated with it. That's how powerful the Legion of Mary was. And the rosary was at the center. They had to, every week in their meetings, pray the rosary. you know, as a way of promoting Christianity.
That is so beautiful. Well, it's great to see that there are both lay and clerics alike who are out there championing the rosary, bringing it in both in modern and throughout history. Mm-hmm. Why do you think, in a very short answer maybe to a very big question, why is it all now? You know, we see this explosion of the rosary in this 20th century. What do you think is at work in that, behind that?
Well, I think we've seen, we're really got an apex. We've got a spiritual battle going on, you know, right now. It's always been going on, of course. But I think it's important to remember that, you know, we're dealing with a fallen angel, a serpent, you know, as described in the New Testament, in the scriptures. Nobody slays a dragon without a sword,
okay?
And we've got a seven-headed hydra, you know, with all these vices that wants to devour us and our families and what's good, true, and beautiful. Unless we have this weapon, what are we going to be able to do? This enshrines the sacred mysteries of the God-man. With this weapon, we can slay dragons, demons. And so in these dark times, we need to have it in our hands again.
Yeah, so there's more challenges, more threats.
Oh, yes, everything's threatened today.
You know, it's no coincidence that Pope Leo XIII, who gives us 11 encyclicals of the Rosary, also gives us the prayer to St. Michael the Archangel.
Yeah, that's what I think, the connection. And then you look at why, right? He was the one who had the prayer because he's heard that conversation.
You can see the next century
That's right,
I mean, Chesterton has a great line. He says, the age is converted most by the saint who contradicts it most clearly. Mother Teresa of Calcutta, for example, holy poverty in the midst of plenty and affluence, profligacy. And the simplicity of Mary against the sophistication of an age symbolized by the depraved Madonna and her vile music.
Right.
I mean, and people put down the rosary because it's just for simple souls who can't read. And then you have a guy like Pope John Paul II, who not only can read, but can read 8 or 10 languages, including Greek, Latin, and Hebrew.
Yeah.
And it belies.
All right, I'm going to hold you there.
The age.
Stay with us for the next segment.
Oftentimes, seeing myself at the side of Mary, wherever she is, in that mystery of the Rosary has really helped me meditate upon just the life of Jesus Christ and the way that the Lord has worked in salvation history just through those moments.
When I pray the Rosary and I come to the decade of Jesus carrying his cross, I think of the pain that he must have endured carrying the cross on his shoulder. And I think of my own pain that I endure every day when I carry my own crosses. And I realize it's nothing compared to what he endured, but it's helpful and comforting to know that he carries his cross and suffers willingly with us.
People recognize Franciscan University as being academically excellent and passionately Catholic. We have the unique opportunity through our faculty members, through our students, to proclaim that academic excellence by reaching out in many different ways. We also remain passionately Catholic in the way in which we are able to worship, the way in which we are able to bring that love of Christ to others on a daily basis. It's important for us to be able to embrace both.
Welcome back to Franciscan University Presents. This entire program springs forth from the very heart of our campus at Franciscan University in Steubenville, Ohio. Our camera and equipment are being operated by our students. We're here in the Communication Arts Studio here on campus at the university. Our regular panelists, our theology professors here at the university, and actually our special guest is an alum, as well as myself, of Franciscan University. Father, so as we talk about the Rosary, let's go deeper in today. You know, we talked about the outpouring of grace, the both in Marian apparitions and explosion of the Rosary as a spiritual weapon. Let's look at today at some people and some of the stories. I just love hearing the stories about those who really are champions today of the Rosary.
Yeah, there have been tremendous number, and many of them I mentioned in my book, but some of them not well known.
Yeah.
You got the servant of God, Father Joseph Kentenich, who founded the Schoenstatt movement.
Yes.
And they even started a rosary campaign that started in South America, and now it's worldwide. You got Blessed James Alberione, the founder of the Pauline family, he never went anywhere without praying a rosary. Yeah, just amazing.
Like hidden, these forgotten.
Right, exactly. And then you've got, of course, the Venerable Fulton Sheen, who even kind of invented his own kind of rosary, the World Mission Rosary. Sometimes you see these rosary with a different color for every decade. Mm. He designed that to pray for a geographical region of the planet with each decade.
Oh. Wow.
Really, really brilliant, wow. You know, to do that. And then, of course, you've got like Saint Pope John the 23rd, actually, who was a great promoter of the rosary. Blessed Paul the 6th, the Pope, who was a great lover of the rosary. And then John Paul II, of course,
right?
I mean, that's,
right.
That's a given, Benedict right. the 16th. Even our current Holy Father prays the rosary.
Right.
But there's one story, if I had to mention it, it's an incredible story from just our time, just 2 years ago, well, 3 years ago now, okay. In Nigeria, a bishop had a vision, and he documents this, he talks about this. Our Lord appeared to him with a sword in his hand. Our Lord had a sword in his hand.
Wow.
And our Lord was gesturing for the bishop to take the sword. So the bishop went to touch it. When he did, it was just mystically transformed into a rosary.
Oh,
and Jesus said to his bishop, Boko Haram is gone. Boko Haram is gone. He said it 3 times. Well, that bishop took that to heart and began a rosary campaign in his area in Nigeria where Boko Haram, this radical Islamic group, is doing horrible things.
Yes.
And that was just 3 years ago. Well, the bishop now gives testimony that Boko Haram is almost entirely eliminated, and even the president of Nigeria, just a few months ago, went on the air and said that due to this bishop and what he's been doing, Boko Haram is almost entirely eliminated.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
I mean, again, Our Lady's sword. It's the weapon. It's the spiritual weapon for our times.
Yeah.
That is powerful. Mm-hmm. And you look at these different examples that you've given, these hidden, some of them we know, but we forget, they were really champions of the rosary. Their spiritual powerhouse, if you will, has been the prayer of the rosary. Yeah. That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah.
Well, it's certainly a lot cheaper than the current weapons system.
Right.
Expensive.
Right.
I mean, what does it cost to mass produce rosaries?
Yes.
But you've got to get people to pray it.
Yeah, that's it.
But, you know, St. Louis de Montfort points out how God prefers to do more with less, you know, and goes on to say specifically that Satan suffers his greatest defeat always through the instrumentality of the Blessed Virgin. Mm-hmm. Because to be defeated by the Almighty, I mean, what creature can withstand God? Yeah. But to be defeated by this lowly, humble virgin, you know, it really is not only the sign of divine success, but also a reminder to us that only if we humble ourselves will he exalt us.
Yeah.
And in my experience, very few things humble me like praying the rosary at least once a day, and sometimes two or three times.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It is a powerful tool whenever you face seemingly insurmountable problems. Mm-hmm. God does more with our less.
Mm-hmm. Amen, amen.
Absolutely.
Well, I want to go to the challenges maybe that some experience in getting the daily rosary or trying to pray that in your family life. Is there anything from the wisdom of the church, the history, the stories that you found that might speak to some of us who might struggle getting our rosary, praying our rosary, if you will?
Absolutely. And I have to be honest, I think we all struggle with
that.
We don't have angelic
intellects.
We can't focus on one thing for 20 minutes with no distractions. You're going to be thinking about what's for dinner or did I respond to that email? You know,
yes.
It happens. Even St. Louis de Montfort, you know, 3 centuries ago, talked about in his masterpiece, The Secret of the Rosary, distractions are going to come.
That's right.
You know, but you just persevere. You get your mind back to the mysteries. Even great saints like Saint Therese of Lisieux, right? The little flower.
Yeah, powerful doctor of the church.
Yeah. She said that she really struggled to pray the rosary.
Yeah.
But she said she knew that Our Lady is her mother and that she'll take all the sweet kisses she can take. You know, even if they're from a child, what does they do? They give butterfly kisses. They're not concentrated. They're just all over the place.
Yeah.
Well, that's oftentimes us when we pray the rosary. But I think that if we persevere, and, you know, you can even use little pictures. You know, there's little pamphlets where you can gaze at a mystery, seeing that mystery, Our Lord crowned with thorns, or whatever the mystery be. It can get you a little more focused, you know, it's helpful, things like that. But the key is to persevere. We're all going to get distracted.
Yeah,
you've got to just work through the distractions.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing that commends it is the tactile quality of it.
Yeah.
I mean, you hold it in your hands.
Yeah.
It's embodied prayer. And it reminds me of the story of Hilaire Belloc. Maybe you've heard this before. He was accosted by some irate constituent, and he needed her vote to get returned to Parliament, and she suspected that he was a papist. And he said, "Yes, madam, I am, and I pray these beads every day on my knee, And if that disqualifies me, then I pray to God that he spare me the indignity of having to represent you in Harlem. But I'm not going to give up these beads.
Right. That's wonderful.
But the idea that you pray them, even when you have difficulty doing so. Yeah. You know, I remember when we were first interviewing here at Franciscan University, my wife and I came, and she was an RCIA, but there were no strings attached. I wasn't sure. In fact, I didn't expect her to come into the church, which she did end up doing that the coming Easter Vigil. But when we were interviewing with Father Michael Scanlon, our dearly beloved, departed spiritual father, it was really interesting because after the professional part of the interview, it got personal. Mm-hmm. And after it got personal with me, he really shifted to her. And then she just kind of shared the fact that she struggles with the Blessed Virgin Mary and devotion like the Rosary. He said, so do I. And we're like, okay, go on. And he did. He shared, even as a priest, I struggle with praying the Rosary. I went for a period without praying it, and then I've come back to it, and Our Lady has kind of revived it. But he said, for quite some time, I struggled. And he said, I still sometimes struggle with distractions. Mm-hmm. And years later, Kimberly identified that as the breakthrough. That is the moment where it's like, if Father Michael Scanlon, the president of Franciscan University, not only struggles but can admit it, then I can struggle and I can admit, Right. And so, you don't see graces coming, but that was a very, very special one. And he also shared how he had been arrested, with pro-life demonstrators, many of whom were evangelical Protestants, and they were in jail up in Youngstown. And not only did they pray the Rosary, but they taught the Protestants how to pray it.
Yes.
And they explained the inner logic of God's love that's contained in the Rosary.
I just remember that, too. I remember those experiences of praying the Rosary with Lutherans and with other Protestants. And it was just a beautiful, you're praying for life. You're praying against an evil culture of death. Yeah. And there you are, united in
quoting
prayer.
Scripture again and again and again.
Right. That's where we draw our faith and our unity from. Yeah. That's great power. Yeah. And there's something very powerful about families, families praying that Rosary together, because it could be an individual prayer that you're praying on your own, but there's also just a beautiful communal nature.
Right.
And if you could speak to the way that we could pray more in common and the power of that, whether it be in the family or in a kind of a community setting.
Oh, you're absolutely right there, because St. Louis de Montfort, once again, he said that Satan finds it easy to break a stick, and St. Louis de Montfort says that's what it's like when one person prays the Rosary. It's strong, but he said when you get multiple people praying it becomes, all these sticks together, it becomes this really strong thing that Satan cannot get at. And the church in her wisdom knows that. That's why we have these associations of prayer associated with the Rosary. That's why, religious communities normally, have it as part of their constitutions to pray the Rosary. But not a lot of people know that you can get a plenary indulgence every day if you pray a Rosary, for example, in a church, in an oratory, or even as a family. You can get a plenary indulgence. I mean, what a blessing that is, not only to yourself, because you can apply it to yourself, or to deceased relatives or loved ones in purgatory.
What is it? Just explain a plenary indulgence real briefly.
So basically what that means is that your complete remission of sin, what you would do time in purgatory for, so to speak, is gone,
Right.
So it's not magic, of course. It's a father's love working through the treasure house of the church to give these paternal gifts to his children. And this is one great one that we can get on a daily basis.
You want a great gift of mercy.
Right. Yeah.
Pray the family rosary.
What a blessing.
It's a mother's love, too. I mean,
And if the family is the domestic church, why shouldn't it be the setting for grace, an occasion for more grace? The Marian multiplier,
there's really something important. Exponential about groups praying it, but it doesn't discourage us from praying it alone.
Of course. Yeah.
And I want to say one thing, too, because I have an admission. I have prayed the Rosary with singular grace of contemplation, maybe once a decade, and I'm not talking about 10. I'm talking about 10.
Is it that often?
Maybe, if I'm exaggerating. But, I find that if God is doing more with less, that isn't just Our Lady, that isn't just the Rosary, it's also my less. Mm-hmm. And so I'll often say, okay, if this is the peasant's breviary, I am the peasant. And I am especially impoverished spiritually, intellectually, when I'm going through this with all kinds of headaches and distractions and stuff. But I do find from time to time, our Lord shows that when we just pray it with perseverance and with humility and distraction and admit, this isn't even, a penny. I'm just giving to you my distracted, my, you know, I'm barely present. I once, every 10 beads, I'll really try to think I'm talking to you, Blessed Father, you know, that's how distracted I am. I just feel like our Lord says, oh yeah. I'll take that.
That's right.
We'll take that.
Absolutely. And it is. It's, in a similar way, sometimes I'm in adoration and I feel like I am distracted or sleepy. Mm-hmm. But I know just by being in the presence mm-hmm. of our Lord that it's that chemotherapy healing mm-hmm. me, you know. Mm-hmm. And just praying the rosary sometimes sleepy for me at least. But it's still, I'm in the presence of our Lord. It's the tactile nature of it. It's meditating on it. It's the petitions. It's the everything. Yep. It's just breathing.
Well, you know, Jose Maria Escriva has a wonderful insight, which mm-hmm. I find really consoling. Mm-hmm. Blessed monotony.
Yes, that's right.
They sort of match and purify the blessed, the unblessed monotony of your sins.
Right. He was a great champion of the rosary also. You know, he wrote a book on the rosary. It's a small book, but he wrote it in one day. You know, and it's out there available for people. But I call him
the
pilgrimage. Yes, that's right. That's right. I call him the pilgrim of the rosary, because everywhere he went, he turned his journey into a pilgrimage, because that's what you do when you pray the rosary. You're making a pilgrimage to the holy sites and places associated with the life of our blessed Lord. Yeah. Your mind, you mentally and spiritually in your heart, going to those places in the Holy Land. You become a pilgrim when you pray the rosary.
This is actually a custom in the work. You know, I was a cooperator before I became a Catholic, and I had a friend who became my sponsor who took me on a May pilgrimage to a local Marian shrine. I'm like, what are we? We're going to pray the entire rosary. Mm. It's the month of May. It's the month of Mary. And then the next year, and the next year. And now I invite family members and friends, and others do too. And it really is something that St. Jose Maria did and still does as a champion of the rosary.
Absolutely. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Good example.
And we may even just, I know you talk about this in a number of occasions in the book, but just the idea that we call it a rosary. That's offering roses, offering a flower to our mother, to our dear mother.
Say it with rosaries.
You know, and it's just, this is so beautiful that this is our little bits, you know, that is offering up. And I don't remember who said it, but that Our Lady takes all these together and she makes them presentable to God in a way that we could never do.
Right.
And that's just the beauty of this. It's just simple, whether you're a high intellectual and mighty person or you're a lowly peasant, this is your prayer. And it's a beauty that the Church has given us that Our Lord and Our Lady have bestowed this special weapon for us at this time.
And I tell people sometimes, you know, I say, let's just break it down in an analogy. You know, I'm not God, I'm not the Messiah, but I'm a son and I have a mother. Well, on occasion, when people meet my mother, they compliment her, but they tell me, they say, oh, Father, your mother is so nice. It's so great to have her on this pilgrimage. You know what, Father, we bought a little gift for your mom. Do you mind? Right. I'm not going to be offended. I'm not going to say, oh, that offends me. How dare you buy a gift for my mother? Well, think about it with Jesus and his mother.
Yeah.
So if we come up to him and say, Lord, we've got all these roses that we want to give to your mother. Is that okay?
Right.
Can we sing a song for your mom? He's not going to be offended. He's going to move him. Yeah. He's going to be like, really? Oh, I'd love to hear it. Please do, you know? Yeah. And I often tell people that, you know, if I had the power on my pilgrimages, for example, people who give gifts to my mother, I want to say to them, you know what? You come to the front of the bus. Well, think about Jesus and his mother. If we pour gifts on his mother, our mother as well, spiritually, he's going to give us special graces.
Amen. Right. Amen. Yeah. Amen. And who would love his mother more than himself? So we can't outdo him in how much
he loves
her.
That's right.
Stay with us for the final segment of Franciscan University Presents.
In Father Don's book, he talks about the rosary as a weapon, and that can sometimes be conceived as a violent image, but Mary offers the rosary to us as a source of comfort, as protection against evil and against Satan.
John Paul II said of the rosary that the rosary is the daily meeting which neither I nor the Blessed Mother neglect. And that quote just completely changed my perspective on the rosary, because it went from being an obligation to being this beautiful daily meeting with our Blessed Mother, who just waits for us as her children to ask for her intercession.
Well, you know, it's been said that one should be a reservoir of grace rather than a channel. And so a reservoir fills itself up with water and then spills over into the surrounding area. So with the rosary, we immerse ourselves in the mystery of Christ and we immerse ourselves in his grace. And then that naturally spills over into everyone that we encounter.
Well, Welcome to the final segment of Franciscan University Presents, where we've been talking to Father Don Calloway about the Rosary. Regis, could you start us off?
Yeah, just a couple of addenda to sort of extend the discussion that we had in that last segment. You were talking about this theme of pilgrimage, and the Rosary becomes a portable pilgrimage. I mean, particularly for people who don't have enough money to go to Jerusalem, or maybe have a sense of safety about leaving Pittsburgh. The Rosary is perfect, and it reminds me of Ignatius of Loyola, who perfected this technique called the composition of place. You just make a mental picture of the scene, and you place yourself there, and there's Jesus. And that's exactly what the Rosary does. It invites you to see Jesus in concrete terms, time, space, vicariously. You're right there with the Blessed Mother, and you can see him as Mary saw him. You know, through her countenance, the whole life of her son floods your mind and gives you all kinds of inspiration. The other thought I had had to do with the disproportion that Mary provides. I mean, here's a woman, a virgin, a mother. She's not much. She doesn't have a lot of throw weight in the world. And yet, through her, she's able to disarm the devil and vanquish evil. I mean, that's wonderfully disproportionate. And another Ignatius, Ignatius of Antioch, speaks of those three secrets that were wrought in the silence of heaven, crying out to be told, which completely confounded the devil: her virginity, the birth of Jesus, and his death on the cross. And all of those mysteries, those shattering revelations, are disclosed in the prayer of the Rosary. And by saying it, you are literally returning to those scenes, which represent the source of salvation. That's wonderful.
Yes. Thank you, Regis. Scott?
First, I want to begin by thanking you for this book. This is a classic. I mean, it really seems too recent to be one, but it's going to become one, and it's going to do a whole lot of supernatural good. The second thing I'd like to do is to underscore again, not just reading the books, but praying the Rosary. Personally, I can remember the first day I prayed my first Rosary, December 31st, 1983. I didn't become a Catholic until 86, but I just gave to her what seemed to be an impossible problem for me as a male. And I just said, you know, as an evangelical Protestant, I've struggled with this, and so I gave it to her. You're a virgin mother, you ought to be concerned. And boy, oh boy, did she give me grace, the likes of which all of my other prayers had never really acquired. And and so when I realized, I just made the resolution to pray it every day, and at least once. But I can also say, as a professor, as an intellectual, you know, I've already emphasized how important it is for making the Gospels come alive. But I can't tell the story. I've shared it with Mike. I owe my doctorate to the Blessed Virgin in general, but I mean specifically to the Rosary prayed one dark night in January in the bitter cold, where it was the end of the rope. I was at the end of my rope, and she just brought something to me. I'm so like, I didn't see it coming. Nobody did. And my supervisor later shared with me, when I told him I owe this doctorate to the Rosary, Our Lady of the Rosary, he's like, I do too. I owe mine. You know? Like, I get it, you know. But I would say men in general, I mean, just husbands and fathers who struggle in this culture with impurity, go to her again and again and again. But I would also say mothers, you know, mothers who have children who have strayed. And what mother doesn't have that these days? Go to her, go with the Rosary, and pray. You know, and just allow the tears to meet the beads, and just discover later on, or sooner or later, the supernatural grace that is released to retrieve souls from hell and to bring them home to heaven. When mothers unite their heart to the Mother of God through the Rosary, you know, we're going to see in eternity what difference that makes.
Amen. Amen. Father Don.
Yeah, you know, what's funny is I hope I don't embarrass you on the show here with the viewers, but I remember when I was a student at Franciscan University, and I remember I was up late one night, and we had recently bought one of our new houses. It was just close to your home. And I remember it was probably about midnight, and I looked outside, and I saw you walking down the street praying a rosary. You don't remember that because I didn't call you out your name or anything, but I remember, this is a guy who's, you know, got a doctorate, or maybe you're struggling through your doctorate at that point. Maybe that was the time.
And other things too.
Right. I was just so inspired by that. And I think that you're right. When we see men doing it, for other men, It's a sign of, maybe I should be doing that more. Or look at this midnight, it's cold out, and here's my professor walking down the street praying a rosary. Just incredible. And I think that for myself, you know, my own conversion and my ongoing conversion, for me, the rosary definitely is therapeutic. You know, it really helps me to put things into my mind, into my heart that are sacred, that are holy. And it really, I find it healing. Mm. You know, if you can take that 20 minutes a day, whether it's on your commute to work or whether it's you're walking the dog or whatever it is, to do that, it really does focus, and you start to live an intentional life. Yeah, you're thinking about the mysteries of Christ and what he's done for us, and it really blesses your entire day. Certain blessings and saints even refer to the rosary as their, quote, evening communion, meaning, you know, they attend morning mass and they really get our Lord body, blood, soul, and divinity in Holy Communion. But in the evening, you know, praying the rosary brings them back to Christ. He's present again, you know, not in that sacramental way, but nonetheless truly there in the mysteries of the rosary. And I definitely want to encourage men, women, to pray it, and to pray it together as spouses. Powerful stuff. St. John Paul II, in his letter in 2002, said when spouses pray the rosary together, they can look each other in the eye. That's amazing, because you're basically exposing yourself and saying, honey, I'm sorry for maybe something I said today. And when you pray that, there's nothing, as Sister Lucia dos Santos from Fatima says, nothing that cannot be overcome with the power of the rosary. So I want to encourage families to pray it, spouses to pray it. I even want to encourage my brother priests to pray it. Mm. You know, St. Louis de Montfort, when he wrote The Secret of the Rosary, his main intention for writing it was to his brother priests.
Wow.
Because a lot of them were, you know, saying, it's not significant, it's of no importance. He said, no, that's not the case. And I think we need to be reminded of that again today, you know, especially my brother priests as well, that we need this on every realm of the church, from the highest to the lowest, from the Pope to the pews, everybody. Yeah. We need the rosary.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. Well, Father Don, thank you both for this book and this great program. If you've enjoyed today's program, we have a handout for you from Father Don, The Rosary, the Spiritual Sword of Mary. You can get it at faithandreason.com or just for calling us. The rosary is given to us for a time of challenge, both in our personal lives and in our world today. We are at war, and we need to recognize that when we enter our battle, we're not battling against flesh and blood, but principalities and powers, the spiritual forces at work. And we need to remind ourselves each morning. I pick up my rosary, and that's what I think each time as I kiss the cross. You know, we're entering into a battle, and am I armed for battle today? When I think about marriage and family life, as been said already, we need families, we need couples praying this, we need mothers teaching their children, fathers teaching them and joining together in prayer. This is what our world needs today. Our Lady will be victorious if only we yield ourselves and humble ourselves before her and let her win the battle for us. I want to invite you to be a part of Franciscan University's mission to educate, to evangelize, and send forth joyful disciples. First, I want to ask for your prayers. What we're about is a work of God, and I need your prayers. But maybe you could join us at one of our dynamic summer conferences or on one of our pilgrimages around the world to holy shrines. Maybe you can come and get your education here at Franciscan University or through our online program. Or go to faithandreason.com to be equipped and sent forth in a powerful way to be agents of the new evangelization. And Father Don, could you close us with your blessing?
Absolutely. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless all who are viewing this program. We thank you for the great gift of the rosary, this Bible on a set of beads, this portable prayer that changes lives. We ask through the intercession of Our Lady of the Rosary and Saint Dominic this blessing in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
To download the free handout on today's topic, go to faithandreason.com. Email your request for the handout to presents@franciscan.edu. At faithandreason.com, you can also purchase past episodes of Franciscan University Presents, or request today's free handout and purchase past programs by calling 888-333-0381. That's 888-333-0381, or call 740-233-6357.